This is what every pilot trains for, an extreme emergency. This pilot has only seconds to react. If he makes the wrong decision, the plane will crash. For everyone on this flight, only the pilot's skill can save them from catastrophe. Around the world, hundreds of thousands of flights take off and land every day. Annually, over 1 billion passengers put their lives in the hands of the men and women who fly them. Emergencies are rare, but they do happen. The majority of these incidents are dealt with swiftly and safely. But sooner or later, even the best pilots will face the unexpected.
If it can happen in the air or to an airplane, it's going to happen. And this time it did happen.
We had never trained with loss of all engines, nor was there a procedure for us to follow. In fact, we were just improvising as we went along.
I saw a spot that for a minute I thought was a bug on my windshield, and shortly after that it sprouted wings and I realized it was an airplane.
I felt a hand tap me on the shoulder, and it was Sergeant Brian Bowerly of the Sioux City Air National Guard. And I'll never forget his words. He says, "You're okay, buddy, I got you, I've got you." And even now, it's an emotional, sorry.
But not every emergency is covered in the rule book. And this is when the skill of the pilot is put to the real test. Larry Fuda, a veteran pilot with 30 years flying experience, came close to disaster in 1989 when a freak combination of events crippled his aircraft.
It was a pretty day, weather was good. We had a very routine flight out of Washington right on into Charlotte. Everything went as it was supposed to go until we made our approach into the Charlotte airport.
Captain Fuda was about to be faced with an emergency he had never before experienced. His landing gear would not come down.
I asked the co-pilot to put the landing gear down, and at that time we had two red lights on the main gear. Our nose gear was down, but our main gear showed that neither gear was down. Instant response to something of that magnitude was that maybe we had an electrical problem. There's no way that both gears could fail at the same time.
At a loss to explain the malfunction, Captain Fuda radioed his base for advice.
I had no idea what was causing it. In fact, the company people, the Boeing people, our maintenance people, nobody could understand why neither main gear was coming down.
Soon, the passengers began to realize that there was something wrong.
Because I had flown before and knew that it was only like an hour, hour and a half to Charlotte, that I knew, wait a minute, something's up because we have not gotten, we're not descending.
Fuda couldn't tell if he had an electrical fault with his warning light or if his landing gear was jammed. He decided to fly over the airport control tower.
Being this close in to the runway at this time, we had to make a decision fast. So I made a low pass across the control tower at Charlotte. And at that time, they confirmed that neither main gear was down and locked. So that kindly threw out the electrical problem.
He would have to try and use G-force to pull the landing gear down.
I climbed the aircraft to 10,000 feet, and we dove it over at a pretty steep angle, right down to 5,000 feet. We have a speed clacker that goes off, and I can recall that speed clacker going off, so I know I was doing 350 knots at that time. And at 5,000 feet, we pulled it out with a G-force. And the right gear came out at that time. So we explained to the passengers that we had one of the gear out, and it was a very uncomfortable ride. However, we were going to try it again.
If you've ever been on a roller coaster, that's exactly what it's like. You go straight up and then you go straight down. And your ears block and all of that, and it's a real fast coming down. I can remember that.
I've never been in the back of an aircraft when it went into a dive like that. As far as an average passenger, I'm sure it frightened them to death.
The second dive failed to free the left side landing gear. Larry Fuda's next strategy was even more daring. He was going to bounce the 737 on the right gear to try and knock the left gear down. He would have to hit the runway at over 170 miles per hour.
If the airspeed gets low, it could be very dangerous. That's the reason why you come in way above landing speed in order to keep the left wing up.
His first attempt failed. Then he turned the aircraft around and tried again. Captain Fuda tried three times to bounce the gear out, but it remained jammed. He had only one option left.
We were getting at the point now to where we were down fuel load-wise, and we was going to have to make a decision fast. Went out and advised the passengers and the flight attendants that we was going to have to land, and for the flight attendants to put the passengers into a crash landing mode.
I didn't know, or I didn't want to think about the end or how bad it was going to be.
As he made the final approach, the captain's main priority was to keep the plane on the runway.
And there was quite a bit of buildings on the side of the runway, our maintenance buildings, and I really didn't want to go into a spin and end up in one of those buildings with 100 passengers on board.
To keep the plane straight, he decided he would have to blow the tires, but this meant going against his training and switching off the anti-skid device.
We thought if we turned the anti-skid off as soon as we touched down, that maybe I could lock the brakes on the side where the gear was down and blow those tires, and that would put enough drag into that side to equalize out the side that did not have the landing gear on it.
His theory worked, and the aircraft held the center line, stopping halfway down the runway.
It wasn't over with once the aircraft was on the ground and everything safe. You know, we had a little fire, we had emergency equipment spraying foam all over the aircraft, and I had 100 passengers in the back that we had to get off.
The passengers escaped unharmed. The only injury sustained was to Captain Fuda. As he jumped from the cockpit window to help his passengers, he broke a finger.
I was very thankful that no one got hurt. And the only reason why I got hurt was going out the window. You know, I don't care if I broke a leg or a neck or whatever, as long as my passengers got off. That's the main concern of anybody in charge of an aircraft, is to get your aircraft and your passengers on the ground safe.
It's amazing that we got out. And the only reason I think we did was because of the pilot being so senior in flying. And I don't know if he's been through things like that before, but he knew what to do. It's amazing that we're still here.
The problem started when the ground crew placed the chocks inside the wheel wells of the undercarriage, forgetting to remove them when the plane was cleared to leave. The plane's initial flight path made things worse.
It all started really on our takeoff procedure out of Washington National Airport. And the procedure out of there is you make an immediate left turn because of a restricted area. And then you make an immediate right turn. Well, when we took off with that immediate left turn, one of the chocks slid in place on the left gear. And when I made the right turn out, it slid in place on the right gear. Well, I've had several people tell me that you could win the lottery before this would happen.
The worst emergency for any flight crew is loss of all engines. This is highly unlikely, but total engine loss would leave a plane with virtually no means of control. This pilot was faced with just such an emergency in 1983. But thanks to his love of flying light aircraft, he saved the lives of 85 people. Captain Bob Pearson, one of Air Canada's finest pilots, returns to a remote airstrip in Manitoba, 20 years after pulling off one of the greatest feats of piloting.
This is the first time back, and certainly my first time flying again in Gimli. A little more relaxed atmosphere than the first time I arrived here.
The last aircraft Captain Pearson landed on this airstrip in 1983 was an Air Canada Boeing 767 with 85 people on board. The 767 was the first wide-bodied plane to have only two engines. The computerized flight deck with its electronic screens instead of dials was also revolutionary. Bob Pearson was in charge of one of the first 767s in Air Canada's fleet. The aircraft began its flight in Montreal and was due to fly onto Edmonton, a flight time of 4 hours. On board were Michelle and Shona Dorius.
We usually fly another airline, not Air Canada. And on my way to pick up the tickets, that other airline was fairly busy. So I decided to go to Air Canada to purchase my tickets there.
2 hours after takeoff, cruising at 41,000 feet, things were about to go seriously wrong. First, a low pressure warning light for the left engine fuel pump came on.
One of the low pressure fuel warning lights illuminated with the oral warning, and our emergency handbook simply showed to shut the pump off. There are two pumps for each tank, that's not a problem.
But within seconds, the second fuel pump also seemed to malfunction.
When the second low pressure fuel warning light came on, this was too much of a coincidence. In a brand new airplane, two pumps would fail on the same flight.
Captain Pearson shut down the left engine and diverted to Winnipeg. But then, the unthinkable happened.
We had just shut down all the services to the engine when the right engine failed. And the reason we knew the right engine had failed was that all of our beautiful gauges had disappeared off the video display terminals.
With both engines shut down, all electrical power was lost.
It was a movie, and the movie just was starting, and then all of a sudden it stopped. At that time, I just thought, well, it's a technical difficulty, so I guess there's no movie, and that's the end of that.
I just remember saying something to Michelle about, I don't hear the motors, I don't hear the engine. And it sort of gave me a weird feeling.
On the flight deck, the crew were in command of an aircraft that had no engines and only a few navigation instruments.
As pilots, we trained in simulators ad nauseum on operating with engine failure, but we had never trained with loss of all engines, nor was there a procedure for us to follow. We were just improvising as we went along. Probably fewer instruments than a pilot would have had at the end of the First World War.
The captain never told us that we had no power or the engines weren't working. I think that was smart of him not to tell us that, because there's not much I can do. Like, I can't go and start his engines for him. He might as well not scare me more than I am.
There was no electrical backup, but Captain Pearson was able to drop down a small propeller from the aircraft's belly. Turned by the airstream alone, it generated just enough hydraulic power to control the three primary flight controls. He was now piloting the world's biggest and heaviest glider.
Well, every aircraft is a glider. If the engines are shut down, they're not a good glider because of the drag of the engines. But every aircraft will glide.
With a rate of descent that was too fast, the crew realized that they could not reach Winnipeg. Their nearest runway was a private airstrip in a place called Gimli.
The prudent thing seemed to be to head for Gimli. Even though it didn't have emergency equipment, the primary goal was to get the airplane safely onto a runway. And at Gimli, there are two 6,800-foot runways.
Captain Pearson was now 6 miles from the runway. With no engines, he would have only one chance at landing. His speed was crucial. Too slow, and the aircraft would drop like a stone. Too fast, and he would overshoot the runway. He decided to risk a maneuver he had only tried before in a light aircraft, a sideslip.
The only way I could control our speed to slow down and to control our rate of descent to maintain a steady glide path was to fly the aircraft inefficiently through the air. And that entailed cross-controlling the rudder and the ailerons. This caused the aircraft to fly in a crab-like situation, which I varied.
Landing a light aircraft while sideslipping is difficult enough. But to attempt it in a wide-bodied jet with no engines requires incredible nerve. For the passengers, the angle of the plane was terrifying.
The back of the aircraft, it was probably the worst part of the flight, was the last 6 miles in the sideslip with this very unusual attitude, with the wings tilted very steeply, one towards the ground, one towards the sky. It probably was quite frightening for the passengers.
When the plane went sideways, I could see down. Right down, and we were really close to the ground, and I saw four golfers on a green with their mouth wide open looking up in the air, and that was so funny. I said, my God, we're in trouble. Because the look on, you know, on these people and standing, looking up in the air was something to see. But then I said, oh, we're in trouble at that point.
I was totally sure that we were going to crash and die.
At the last second, only 40 feet above the ground, Captain Pearson had to straighten up his aircraft.
Now, as we come over the threshold of the runway, we straighten the aircraft out. Keep it going down, normal flare, and touchdown.
Bob Pearson had achieved the impossible. He had brought a jet airliner down from 41,000 feet with no power and landed safely. But the nose wheel had collapsed halfway down the runway, sending up sparks.
The attendants were really adamant that we have to get out of the aircraft right now, leave right now, and they also had told us not to stay close to the aircraft. And they said, get out right now and go away from the aircraft.
Everyone was evacuated in case of fire, but there was none. The aircraft had run out of fuel. A faulty fuel gauge on board the plane was compounded by an error in converting from imperial units to metric units when the plane was refueled. The aircraft had taken off with only half the fuel needed. Loss of all engines in daylight is bad enough, but one pilot has experienced even worse. In June 1982, a British Airways 747 jet with 247 people on board flying at night and over the ocean was heading straight for disaster. British Airways Captain Eric Moody was flying his 747 from Kuala Lumpur to Perth when suddenly his engines began to fail.
Well, when the first engine failed, yes, you don't like it, but it's nothing to worry about. So my reaction was, oh, let's shut it down. The flight engineer then said something like, gosh, number two's gone, number three's gone, and something like, oh, golly gosh, we've lost the lot. So we had no engines going. At that stage, you don't believe it's happening, and you take a second look and you take a third look.
The passengers knew from the sound that all power was lost.
We heard the most frightening sounds, as though the engines were running on gravel. It was a grating, crunchy sort of sound. And then they became quite intermittent, and eventually, one after another, they just stopped. After that, it was just an eerie silence.
Captain Moody put his aircraft into a dive to try and reignite the engines at a lower altitude, where there is more oxygen to burn.
We're up at 37,000 feet, but we don't really expect them to happen because of the density of the air and that sort of thing until you get to 29,000 feet. But we were taught to try. So the first few attempts, we didn't expect anything to happen. But when we got to 29,000 feet, we did, and of course, nothing happened.
Captain Moody was unaware that the aircraft was flying through volcanic ash from an eruption on the island of Java. The ash had clogged up the engines and caused them to fail. As the crew pumped fuel into the engines to reignite them, the passengers were horrified to see huge flames.
We noticed bright red flames come out of the engine and were floating past the aircraft. Incorporated with that were sort of fireballs as well, coming out and, well, one after the other.
Well, it looked like blow torches coming out the back of these engines, and I do believe that some of them thought the engines were on fire.
It was about that time that we got this quite startling announcement from the captain.
I said, ladies and gentlemen, this is your captain speaking. We have a small problem. All four engines have failed. We're doing our utmost to get them going, and I hope you're not in too much distress.
The captain maintained his airspeed by diving steeply and then pulling up sharply.
The aircraft seemed to have a bucking action, rather like a roller coaster. It went slowly uphill. This was the sensation we felt. Slowly uphill, paused at the top, ready for that death-defying dive on the other side. And that's how it felt. And I had a real fear that the aircraft would break up in the air.
Desperately, the crew kept trying to restart the engines.
I would think probably 40, 50, 60 times in between. I have no idea how many times we tried, but we would have gone on trying till we could try no more.
With no land for miles, the captain decided he had no choice but to ditch the aircraft, a difficult and dangerous maneuver.
It was dark. I couldn't see anything. And I knew judging the height above the sea at night is not easy when everything's going for you. What I didn't know at the time, my lights were sandblasted, so I've had no lights to help me. So I think probably it was impossible.
After gliding for an agonizing 14 minutes and dropping 25,000 feet, the engines suddenly burst into life. The aircraft had flown out of the volcanic ash cloud, allowing enough air back into the engines. But landing the 747 was not going to be easy. The captain's windshield had been sandblasted by the ash, making it impossible to see. Several vital electrical systems had also been destroyed. Stand up and
look. I had to stand up and look round the side of the front windscreen, and I flew the aeroplane standing up. The flight engineer who sat between the two pilots manipulated the throttles, and I called out the power settings I wanted to maintain the speed that the co-pilot was calling out, and he was also calling out the height that we were and the distance from the runway. So it was a real team effort to get us on the ground.
The aircraft landed safely with no casualties.
There was a stunned silence for a few seconds, and then the whole aircraft burst into a round of applause, cheering, hugging each other, a little bit of weeping, and it was just a wonderful feeling to be back on terra firma.
As soon as we touched down, all the negative thoughts that I had regarding wings falling off, oxygen failing, diving into the sea, all disappeared, and I felt a great sense of relief and a great thankfulness to the crew and to God, knowing that I had life ahead of me.
The aircraft's engines were practically ruined, and it cost millions of dollars to repair the 747. Captain Moody was later awarded a commendation by the Queen for his actions.
I had no reaction whatsoever. I had no life flashing before me on the way down. I had no nightmares afterwards. And in fact, the only thing that happened was my hair. And within 6 months of the incident, a little white patch formed up here. And within another 6 months to a year, I'd gone fair all over. So I have to put that down to being frightened.
At the world's busiest airports, aircraft can take off or land every 60 seconds. In just one day, that's up to 2,000 planes. Air traffic controllers are responsible for keeping all these aircraft apart.
Traffic southeast of Boeing 757 for the south.
Every day, they shepherd thousands of flights safely through their airspace.
Traffic southeast,
Pono 139, thank you. Follow him to the airport.
Air traffic controlling is like a complex three-dimensional puzzle.
Pono 26, traffic is still 6 miles east of you, leaving your altitudinal factor.
Pilots must rely on the air traffic controllers to guide them through this maze.
Etika 146, maintain 250 knots.
The chances of a mid-air collision are incredibly slim. But tragically, they do happen.
757 by the south complex, heavy Boeing 767.
In 1977, a Boeing 727 approaching San Diego Airport collided with a light aircraft over the suburbs. Both planes crashed to the ground and disintegrated. All 135 on board the 727 and the two occupants of the light aircraft died. Seven people on the ground also lost their lives. The worst ever mid-air collision happened near Indira Gandhi Airport, Delhi. A Saudi Arabian Airlines 747 with 312 on board collided head-on at 14,000 feet with an Air Kazakhstan cargo plane with 37 crew and passengers. There were no survivors. But a mid-air collision is survivable. William Querry, a pilot for Atlantic Southeast Airlines, was flying his commuter plane to Atlanta with four passengers. He had taken off from an airport with no air traffic control tower and was being extra vigilant.
Well, we're accelerating up past through about 200 knots. I saw a spot that I thought was a bug on my windshield, and I hadn't seen it before, and I was staring at it, and it suddenly developed a spinner, which is a portion of the nose cone of an airplane. And shortly after that, it sprouted wings, and I realized it was an airplane that we were head-to-head on.
Captain Querry's plane was heading straight toward a Cessna light aircraft.
First, you've got to identify the fact that it is an airplane, and then it takes just maybe a few microseconds to decide which way to go to try to avoid it. So the closure rate of two craft coming head-on was probably over 300 knots. And the estimate was we had something like 6 seconds to miss it, and probably took 2 to 3 seconds to come to a reaction. And then, of course, the aircraft's got to respond to the control inputs. So we were pretty much at the ragged edge of having enough time to avoid.
The captain took evasive action, but it was too late.
I watched the aircraft go over top of us, and I thought we had missed it. Then we had an impact, very loud impact. And the aircraft pitched nose down.
The impact destroyed most of the tail of Captain Querry's aircraft. His plane nosedived out of control.
At the time, I had no conception that we could successfully get the plane on the ground. I felt the plane was going to crash, and what I wanted to do was pick a spot that wouldn't damage any people. And there was a river handy, and I was going to head for the river.
As the aircraft plummeted over 3,000 feet, Querry decided the only way to stop their fall was to use brute force.
I had a quite large first officer, and I asked him to get on the controls and help me. He put his feet up on the instrument panel and started pulling real hard. And with the two of us pulling, we were able to reduce our rate of descent to an acceptable rate. Well, realize when your adrenaline's pumping through you, you do a lot that you don't realize you can do.
With both Querry and his first officer wrestling with the controls, communication was vital.
A slight problem develops in that one doesn't know when one's pulling and the other's pushing, so we had to coordinate that verbally. I'm coming back, I'm pulling back, down a little bit, up a little bit, that sort of thing.
Captain Querry landed safely at his destination. The Cessna pilot and passenger hit the ground and died. Even though he was given one of the highest awards civil pilots can receive, the accident still haunts him.
I was upset because a mid-air should never happen. And it was I felt it was my fault. Should have seen him.
Some emergencies are more bizarre and unpredictable than others. No pilot would ever believe that they could end up hanging outside their aircraft at high altitude. But this is exactly what happened in 1990 when a British Airways captain was sucked out of the cockpit when his windscreen blew out. Flying at 17,000 feet, Captain Tim Lancaster suddenly saw his window begin to move. It then blew out, the decompression tearing him from his seat. His head, arms, and torso were sucked out, and he was battered against the fuselage at close to 350 miles per hour. The outside temperature was minus 54 degrees.
My last recollections on the airplane, I was actually sitting looking through the windscreen when it disappeared, and I saw it go, and I remember a very large bang, which was obviously explosions of the air all went out. And then, I suppose it must have been shortly after that, I remember it being very windy, once again when my the upper half of my body was out of the window, and my next recollections really are waking up in hospital.
The purser, Nigel Ogden, managed to grab the captain's legs before he was completely sucked out of the plane. For nearly 30 minutes, Ogden held on to the captain as the first officer made an emergency landing. Captain Lancaster suffered fractures to his arms, frostbite, and shock. The windscreen that blew out had been replaced the previous night, but the maintenance crew had mistakenly used the wrong bolts. The average passenger might believe that if they were involved in an air disaster, there would be no chance of survival. It may seem that there is little point in listening to the safety demonstration. But in fact, there are survivors in a high percentage of aircraft accidents. This is all that was left of a United Airlines DC-10 after it crash landed in Sioux City, Iowa in July 1989. The aircraft should never have made it to a runway. But thanks to the extraordinary skills of an off-duty pilot called Denny Fitch, nearly 200 people walked away from this wreckage. On July 19, 1989, Captain Denny Fitch was returning home to Chicago as a passenger on United Flight 232.
The trip home was an off-duty situation. I was not to be performing anything. I was basically looking for lunch and a nice glass of Merlot and a ride home for my to see my family.
Another of the 296 on board was Jerry Schemmel, a sportscaster for the Denver Nuggets.
I was traveling with my boss, Jay Ramsdell was his name, and Jay and I had known each other for several years, but he just hired me about 3 months before this. The flight was supposed to take off at 7 a.m. When we got there about 6:30, we found out our flight was canceled. Of all things, mechanical problems with the plane we're gonna fly on that day. We get put on standby for four different flights, and finally the fourth standby flight's when we got on, which turned out to be United Flight 232. I don't think I've ever been more relieved to get on a plane in my whole life. I've been waiting there for almost 7 hours to board a plane. By the time I sat down in my seat on that plane, I think I was as relieved as I've ever been with a flight.
An hour after takeoff, United 232 was in trouble.
We were cruising along at 37,000 feet, and there was a loud, muffled explosion that came from the rear of the aircraft. It had quite a physical impact on the aircraft. The aircraft yawed severely to the right. The nose shifted to the right quite abruptly. And that was followed by 10 seconds of very violent airframe shuddering. And I would liken that to driving your automobile at very high speed down a cobblestone road.
It was a massive explosion. First thing I thought was a bomb has gone off. I think the explosion itself set the panic off, but then when the plane started to drop and we went into a fall, then complete chaos set in.
The tail-mounted engine had suffered a massive mechanical failure. A fan disc installed with a tiny, undetectable defect finally cracked after nearly 20 years in service. Instantly, the pilot shut down the engine and continued to fly the plane.
And so most train maneuver we do, so after that analysis came, relieved that that's what it was. I knew the pilots were very well trained. I train them, and I know how good their training is, and so I felt very comfortable that they can continue and land safely on the remaining two engines.
But Denny Fitch was unaware that this flight was in even greater trouble. He tried to reassure a flight attendant.
I simply told her that don't worry about this. This thing flies fine on two engines. We simply need to get to a lower altitude where the air is more dense. We're going to be fine. And she looked at me and said, "Oh no, Denny, we have just come from the cockpit. Both the pilots are trying to fly the aircraft, and the captain has told us that we have lost all our hydraulics."
When the engine exploded, pieces of metal pierced the tail and severed the main hydraulic lines. The pilots were left with no way of flying the plane.
Captain Haynes got on the PA system and said that the number two engine explosion caused a lot of damage to the rear of the aircraft. And he said, these are exact words, he said, I'm having a lot of trouble controlling the plane. When a captain tells you he's having a lot of trouble controlling the plane, things must be pretty serious, or he wouldn't say that. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, if he's telling us that, we've got to be in trouble. I better start listening to flight attendants. I better start getting ready for a crash landing.
Denny Fitch was asked to step up to the flight deck to help the crew. What he saw was beyond belief.
I look forward to find both pilots with their control yokes in a complete full left turn. To do this in a normal airplane, you are going to make a very sharp turn to the left. And instead, this airplane continued to fall off to the right. In other words, totally unresponsive to the control inputs. And that's when I realized that, in fact, the worst had happened. The unthinkable had indeed occurred.
United 232 had lost all flight controls. The crew radioed United's maintenance base for help, but no one could believe that all hydraulic control had been lost.
And it took a laborious step-by-step process before finally they had to accept it. And I was once told that among those people, they were looking at each other and said, we're talking to four dead men.
In the main cabin, the passengers sat waiting, not knowing what their fate would be.
If the feelings of helplessness were overwhelming, I think for myself and for several others, I thought about the fact that I might not make it. And I thought a lot about that, in fact. I began to think about the things I had done to that point. The last three words I told my wife that day were, I love you. I just bought a new life insurance policy, so that the practical matter of my wife having money if I were to pass away entered my mind. And I added those things up and I thought, maybe it's my time to go. Maybe I'm being told something here. And then I thought about the fact that I might not make it when we hit the ground.
On the flight deck, the crew did have one crude way of controlling the aircraft.
Captain gave me, by the way, I'm a total stranger in this cockpit. They don't know me. I'm in civilian clothes. And the captain gave me the only thing that was controlling his aircraft, in effect, was his throttles.
By increasing the thrust to one engine and decreasing it to the other, Denny Fitch managed to steer the aircraft. For over 40 minutes, he guided the plane in this fashion to the nearest airport at Sioux City, Iowa.
By the last 15 or 20 minutes, I think we were ready to go. It was like, let's just get this thing over with. We've gone through emergency landing procedures, we're ready mentally, physically. Let's get this thing over with, and it just kept dragging on and on and on.
Emergency services were scrambled for a crash landing. With 10 minutes to go before they reached the airfield, Captain Haynes prepared the passengers.
Captain Haynes told us, I'm not going to kid anybody, this is going to be rough. He said, this is going to be rougher than anything you've ever been through. Please be ready. The thought to me at that point was, this cockpit captain is making sure we understand this is going to be a crash. We're not going to land this plane safely. We're not going to walk off this thing when we come to a halt. And I knew and feared the worst at that point.
With no flaps to slow down for landing, United 232 was coming in much too fast.
If we could get it on the runway, that was perfect because that gave us a hard surface. And somehow, some way, if I could just keep this thing steered with reverse thrust on the ground, we may run off the end of the runway. We may go into that cornfield at the far end. Corn would slow us down, we'd stop, eight doors would open, 296 souls would slide down, and we all go to the nearest bar and I would buy. I really believed with my whole heart that we were going to pull this off. I really did.
Just before landing, Denny Fitch pushed the engines to full throttle to lift the nose.
I just put all the power I could get out of the engines, put the throttles full forward, hoping that power would bring the nose up and arrest that sink rate and we'd land like a duck would on water. And it was, the timing was just not quite good enough.
Flight 232 hit the runway at over 200 miles per hour.
In We hit so hard, I recall my hands flew off the throttles by the impact, and I was facing forward in the seat, and it's like a giant hand was behind my head and slammed my face down into the radio rack. And there was a tearing of metal, tremendous noise, there was an engine screaming outside.
I wasn't quite ready for just how hard we hit. It felt like we just dropped out of the sky and hit the ground. And I looked around, glanced from side to side at that point, and I saw people being thrown about in the cabin in the first couple of seconds after we hit down. And I thought to myself, we have hit down incredibly hard, and there's probably already some people who are dead in this plane. Then all this debris, just unrecognizable stuff being thrown everywhere inside the plane.
I could feel my body going up and over. And in fact, the airplane was rolling up on its nose. And we pogo-sticked with the nose of the aircraft, the cockpit, if you will, embedding into the field. And I can remember the windshield going brown and green. I can remember in real time the air conditioning still blowing on my shoulder. And then the window cleared for a split second. It darkened a second time. And then there was heat and humidity and just more violence than I can possibly bring to words. The next thing I remember is that I was upside down and I was impacted and trapped in the wreckage with great pain and heart difficulty in breathing. And my eyes and ears were filled with mud and I couldn't hear or see anything.
The plane had cartwheeled along the runway, broken up, and come to rest in a cornfield.
It was very strange. Number one, to get out of a totally dark, smoke-filled plane into this bright sunshine, it was almost blinding, and realized that I was in a cornfield. I think the full scope of what had really happened hit me at that point, because I realized what I was looking at, where I'd come from, was only part of that plane. The rest of it was somewhere else.
When you look at the wreckage of our cockpit, it's indistinguishable mass of metal. Nobody would have dreamed anybody was in there.
The flight crew, all four still alive, were trapped inside their cockpit for 30 minutes.
When I was taken from the wreckage, I will never forget this as long as I live, I felt a hand tap me on the shoulder, and it was Sergeant Brian Bowerly of the Sioux City Air National Guard. And I'll never forget his words. He says, "You're okay, buddy, I got you, I've got you." And even now, it's an emotional,
The crew's exceptional skill in landing this unflyable plane saved the lives of 184. But sadly, 102 others did perish. For those who did walk away, feelings of guilt began to surface. Jerry Schemmel, who lost his friend, also remembers a young child sitting near him.
He's 2.5 feet away from me, and one moment he's alive, and the next moment he's dead. And I had a rough time with that, which I never expected. I always felt like I could look in the mirror and see the luckiest guy in the world. I survived this thing when everybody around me didn't. And that's the way I wanted to feel, but it just wouldn't let me. The guilt of surviving hit me really hard.
I think that what I did that day, I'm very much at peace with. I've flown that approach 1,000 times in my mind. I've beaten myself up. I've given it every opportunity to find some chink that I could have made better. In the previous 25 years, there's 1,200 fatalities and loss of control in flight. It's never had a successful outcome. Somehow we did it. In some miracle, we did it.
What they did was just a little bit short of a miracle in my mind. It doesn't really add up physically that they were able to keep that plane in the air. Everybody connected with Flight 232, I think, from the survivors to the families, the people who didn't make it, say thank you to that cockpit crew.
Air accidents can happen for many different reasons. But when there is a real emergency, the only people we can rely on to bring us safely back to Earth are the pilots. Thank you.